Hi, my name is Jenny Bolt. I'm with the Drinking Water and Environmental Health Division of the Michigan Department of Environment, Great Lakes, and Energy. We're going to be going over the lead and copper sample site plan that's due from Public Water Supplies January 1st, 2020. It's going to be a general overview. If you've possibly missed some of our other trainings, we're going to have a separate video that's just going over the form itself. To review, we're going to go through a little bit of the changes to the tiering criteria and the 2018 revisions to lead and copper provisions of the Michigan Safe Drinking Water Act. So in general, the rule sets up tiering criteria that all sites are determined to be tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, or other. And where you should be sampling for compliance is based on the risk of lead-containing materials and lead exposure. All systems should be sampling tier 1 sites unless they don't have tier 1 sites, and then they must exhaust all higher tier options before moving to a lower tier like tier 2, 3, or other. If possible, you should be using the same sampling locations over and over to reduce variability. And then with the revisions to the rule, we've refocused the tiering criteria slightly to focus more on lead. So just as review, the service line is the discharge of the corporation fitting, and that's at the main, the water main, and includes the service line, that's the pipe that connects the water main to the home, and 18 inches into the home or the first shutoff valve, whichever is shorter. And then if any portion of that is lead, that includes any lead pigtail, gooseneck, or other lead fitting connected between that discharge of the corporation fitting to 18 inches within the home is of a lead-containing component, then it is a lead service line. Just to go over a quick diagram, you've got the water main that's out in the street. You've got the corporation fitting that comes off the main. That's the discharge of that corporation fitting is the start of the lead, of the service line. And then it goes all the way into the home to the first shutoff valve or 18 inches, whichever shorter. And if any portion of that service line is lead, then it's a lead service line. So how this translates into the tiering criteria is that if a home, a single family residential home, has a lead service line or lead interior plumbing, that's a tier one site with the highest risk of lead exposure, and that you would sample all of those locations before moving to a lower tier site. Tier 2 is the same criteria with a lead service light or lead interior plumbing, but isn't a single family residential home. It's a multifamily residence or other building. Tier 3 is then any single family residential site that's been built before 1988 and has copper plumbing with lead solder. And then if you've exhausted all of those options, then you're to other sites. And other sites should be chosen based on representative plumbing materials that are found in the distribution system. Also part of this is galvanized service lines. Galvanized service lines pose a potential source of lead exposure and have been written into the 2018 rule revisions. But how they affect tiering criteria is if that lead portion is still there connected to a galvanized service line in that top scenario, it would be a tier 1 if it's a single family residential home, or a tier 2 if it's a multifamily home or other building. Once that lead portion of the service line has been removed, you know, this may have happened historically, but for some through some other project. But if it's only the galvanized portion that still remains, it's no longer a lead service line and is considered to be a tier 3 or other based on the plumbing materials in the home. Tier 3 would be if that home has copper with lead solder before 1988, and other would be any other type of building material. So the lead and copper sampling plan has you put these tiering criteria and these chosen and these sites that are chosen based on risk of lead exposure into a plan for your normal compliance sampling. Like I said, it's going to be required for every community and non-transient, non-community supply, and needs to be to Eagle by January 1st, 2020. We do have a sampling plan form that includes instructions, and it's available on the Eagle website at michigan.gov/LCR for lead and copper rule. The number of sampling sites for any given public water system is based on population. And if you'll see the two different columns, there's one column for standard monitoring, and there's one column for reduced monitoring. If you're a system that's sampling annual or triennial, you're on reduced monitoring. What the sampling plan requires you to do is plan for a number of sampling sites based on the standard monitoring. So you may have only been taking 10 sites for your reduced monitoring, but you need to plan for your standard monitoring of 20 sites if you're a system between 501 to 3,300 people served. In addition to that, you have to have the minimum number of sites in your sampling plan be the standard number, but preferably you would also add in some additional alternate sites. And we're recommending that you have about 1.5 times the standard number of sites. So I've got two examples down at the bottom here, a system that serves 20,000 people and a system that serves 2,000 people. For the system with 20,000 people, the standard monitoring is 60 sites. If you look at your current monitoring schedule and you're of that same population bracket, but you're only sampling 30 sites, you're more than likely on a reduced schedule, either annual or triennial. Your standard is 60, what should be on your sampling plan is 60 sites, and then we're also recommending this buffer to have between 60 and 90 sites. For a sample with for a system with 2,000, more than likely you're sampling 10 sites, your standard monitoring is 20 sites, and your plan should include 20 to 30 sites to have that buffer for your standard number of sites that's required in the sampling plan. We have instructions in the plan. Like I said, it's also in online at michigan.gov/LCR. And there's a checklist to go along with this as well, with the main purpose of it being to review your current sites, retain those sites with the new, if they still apply and are your highest risk based on those changes to the tiering criteria, replace any of those sites as necessary, and identify new appropriately tiered sites if you need them to get up to that standard number of samples. All right, if you guys have any questions, sorry, skipped ahead just a little bit. Like I said, the document is available for your convenience online in either Word or PDF, depending on if you'd like to fill it on online, and you should submit that to your local district email box by January 1st, 2020. Just to review, these plans are not static documents. They should be routinely evaluated, especially if you find something in your distribution system that's of a higher tier that you should be sampling and should be included in your plan. A couple of examples would be is if you've had an entire lead service line replaced, that you would need to reevaluate the tier of that site. If it's no longer a high risk tier, then you would not include that in your sampling plan and you would replace it with another higher tier appropriate site. If you've had a major home remodel be done, especially in that copper with lead solder before 1988, that may change the tiering criteria of the site and you should reevaluate whether or not it should be included in your plan. And then if you're a system that didn't know that they had lead service lines but found them through some type of project, that would change what the highest tier criteria you would have in your distribution system and where you should be sampling for your compliance samples. And that would also mean that you need to document that as far as updating your sampling plan with those sites. Within the sampling plan, like I said, you should use the same sites if possible, but there are always reasons that you may need to find an alternate site and choose a different site that's already on your plan, but that's where that buffer comes in. These are still samples that are taken at private residences. The homeowner can refuse, it may be vacant, or it's had one of those scenarios where you've had a change in tiering criteria, or the homeowner has chosen to install a point of use or point of entry treatment device such as a softener, a filter, or a reverse osmosis device. And that would also change whether or not you should be sampling at that location. If you have any questions regarding this, please contact Heather Jackson or myself at the email addresses and numbers listed on the slide. Thank you very much.